be thanking that as we come to the Lord's Supper later on, we're going to remember that Jesus died and shed his blood for us. But Father, we thank you, the story didn't end there. He rose again and ascended. And so, Father, we can have a relationship with you if we believe in Jesus. Be with us now. Encourage our hearts during this time. For it's in Jesus' name we ask these things. Amen.
Amen.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Okay, on page 599 of your worship of your hymnals, we're going to read number 2, the call to worship.
Come, let us sing for joy to the Lord. Let us shout aloud to the rock of our salvation. Let us come before him with thanksgiving and extol him with music and song.
Well, we have just a few words of announcements before we do get in the rest of our service. First of all, if we can move to birthdays and anniversaries. Okay, Doug Orlov has a birthday this week, and so if you are with him on Facebook, be sure and wish him a happy birthday. Mary Barrett has one coming up. Annabelle Martinez. Charlotte McGuire, that is Dan's friend. She's not with us this morning. But, and then Alice Fall. We have an anniversary, and that's Nate and Glenda Ewer. So be sure and wish them a happy anniversary as well. All right, moving right along, we want to remind you that it is Christmas in October. And actually, I want to go ahead one more slide, because we were contacted this week from the Philippines. And actually, there was like 3 different contacts. And 3 different individuals got a hold of us to thank us for Operation Christmas Child. Now, what is interesting is we had already known that some of our boxes this year went to South Africa. In the past, they had gone to Mongolia, they had gone to Venezuela. Well, this year, some of our boxes went to the Philippines. And this is one of the ladies. child boxes for his glory. Now, so far we had like 363, something like that, 362, and then a lady brought 185 boxes for us because she had to go to Arizona for the winter. So you can do the math at 362 to 185. But again, we have until November in order to complete this project. So we have extra boxes available. We have a list of things if you will lend these boxes. And so if you want to do any work on your own at home, please let us know. The coin jar is then for shipping costs. And as of last week, $443.47 had come in towards shipping. And the lady that brought the 185 boxes, she is going to ship her own, pay for her own. She's sending that money in. So anyway, we are well on the way. That is what that is all about. So keep up the good work. So again, Venezuela, Mongolia, South Africa, and now the Philippines have received boxes that our crew, Virginia being our esteemed leader, thank you, Virginia, and then Debbie, who's helped a lot in treating this for the summer, and Kathy, and Dan, and
Sandy,
and
Sandy,
the grandkids back there that have helped.
Sandy,
I don't want to forget anybody. There's a number of people, the Jaramillo boys, and so, anyway. So, keep up the good work. All right, let's move right along. As we pray for I wanted to make a mention about tonight. Let me back up. Tonight in our evening fellowship hour, we're going to be showing a video presentation entitled God, the Bible, and Two Presidents. This is a video of a man by the name of Amir Safati speaking. I mentioned this last week as I was in the book of Exodus and talking about the fact that there arose a Pharaoh who knew not Joseph. Anyway, Amir Safati came to the United States and he spoke at a prophecy conference. And you need to hear what he has to say. This is a word of encouragement. This is a Jew who's a believer, an Israeli born in Jerusalem, who is looking at afar at the United States and has been praying for the United States, asking what is going on in the United States. And he takes us to the Old Testament, and he takes us to a series of passages in the Old Testament that prove that God is still on the throne, that God knows the end from the beginning, and that God has a plan for prophecy that must be fulfilled, and that he uses different individuals to help fulfill these prophecies. Now, if that whet your appetite, I hope it did, come tonight at 6 for the video. At 5:30, if you come a little bit earlier, we have some wonderful snacks available. We have some good time of fellowship and sharing with one another. And then we watch and then we talk about this, share afterwards. So that's tonight. All right, so we talk about the prayers for Jerusalem. Prime Minister Boris Johnson of the United Kingdom, we often call it England or Great Britain, came out this week with a firm stand for Israel. He said, quote, "Under this government, the UK's support for Israel's security will be unflinching. The Conservative Party stands firmly with Israel." That is a good word out of the United Kingdom. Many of you know that in the United States, there was a great debate in our Congress, and finally, they passed a special measure, a standalone measure, for the United States to contribute towards the Iron Dome. If you don't know what the Iron Dome is, you'll know that rockets are being launched into Israel on a regular basis, both from Gaza, both from the north. And the only way that Israel has to protect itself is through a missile defense system. It's called the Iron Dome. It costs a lot of money to operate something like this, and I'm thankful that we in the United States are still helping Israel with the Iron Dome. But let's be praying, be thankful that there are other countries, at least at this point, who are still willing to stand with Israel. All right, as we move on to Alliance Prayer Requests, there's a very special announcement, and I hope you will read your bulletin. It has to do with this sign on to the Alliance website, they are having something called For All the World, a Night of Generosity. This is to be an opportunity to celebrate what God has done, is currently doing, and what we will trust He will continue to do through the pioneering missionary spirit that He has breathed into us. There's a list of things that are going to be taking place, when they will be. If you go online, I believe you need to actually register for this event. But this is a way to reach out to people around the world to be a part of what the Alliance is doing. We can't all get together and fly to a certain location. This year, there was a council in Nashville, Tennessee. But again, because of COVID and other things, people are limited. But in your own living room, you can sign on and be a part of this event. And so please be praying for this event that many will be able to participate. It says, we hope you'll join us as we celebrate together the past, present, and future fulfillment of our vision, which is all of Jesus for all the world. All of Jesus for all the world. All right, let's pray. Father, we thank you for your love. And Father, we thank you for the way you are working in our midst. Father, we thank you that in Israel, there are still friends out there in the world that are willing to support Israel and their security. We thank you for Boris Johnson in the United Kingdom. Father, we thank you for the United States Congress and their vote to support the Iron Dome. But Father, we know that you are the one who is bringing your people back from the four corners of the world. And Father, we know that ultimately you are going to be the one who defends them in the end of times. But Father, we pray that in the meantime, you will be Israel's friend. And Father, we thank you for the Alliance. And Father, we thank you for what you're doing around the world. And Father, we pray that on Friday night, this will be an encouragement for people to sign in and to hear what you're doing, to listen to these testimonies, these stories of what you're doing around the world. And help us, Father, as the Alliance family, to partner together, to be a part of this great vision that you've called us to present all of Jesus to all the world. Help us now, we pray, for it's in Jesus' name we ask these things. Amen. All right, according to my bulletin, it says that it's the Lord's Supper Sunday. And so we go from the missionary moment time into the message. So let me switch gears. Again, we do things a little bit differently on the Sunday when we celebrate the Lord's Supper. All right, so if you have your Bibles, please turn to the book of Exodus and chapter 2. We're going to be in verses 1 through 15. We're going to talk about phase 1 in the life of Moses. And so the plot thickens. Have you ever read that in a book, in a great novel, maybe a mystery novel? And the plot thickens. Well, we are looking at one of the greatest stories in all of history. The thing is, it is a true story. It's not a myth. It's not something that was concocted. It all surrounds the children of Israel and their predicament in the land of Egypt. Now, for those of you who aren't very familiar with the Bible, you might say, well, wait a minute. I thought the children of Israel lived in Israel. What in the world are they doing down in Egypt? Well, remember that the family of Jacob, whose name is changed to Israel, went to Egypt because of the great seven-year famine. Egypt had grain because of Joseph, Jacob's favorite son. He had been sold into slavery into Egypt by his very own brothers. He had interpreted Pharaoh's dream and become prime minister of Egypt. He had stored up during the seven good years. Jacob, or Israel's family, had been welcomed into Egypt because the Pharaoh appreciated Joseph. Now, that Pharaoh had died. So had Joseph, so had his generation. A new Pharaoh came along. You might say a new governor, a new administration, who did not know Joseph and did not know his story. He viewed the children of Israel as a threat and wanted all of their newborn sons dead. Dead. However, God had a plan. It centered around one man. What was that man's name?
Moses.
Moses. Now, Moses' life, very interestingly, can be divided into three equal parts, or three equal phases. Each one is 40 years long. So we have birth to age 40, 40 to age 80, and 80 to age 120. Now, I got a very important question. Is there anybody here today who is older than 120? Okay, we got one. Dan, alright. But for the rest of you, if you are under the age of 120, there's still hope for you. In fact, if you're age 80 to 120, you get ready, because God is ready to use you. Alright? We're going to take a look at phase one of Moses' life, birth to age 40, okay? And so if you are under the age of 40 here today, you really need to hear this, but so do the rest of us, so do the rest of us. So let's take a look at the rest of the story. Our key verse this morning will be in Exodus chapter 2, verse 10, where it says this, "Now the child grew, and she brought him to Pharaoh's daughter, and he became her son. And she called his name Moses, and said, because I drew him out of the water." So the point is this. In phase one of Moses' life, he tried to deliver his people in his own strength and wisdom. And really, I should probably also say in his own time. In his own time, in his own strength, in his own wisdom, this young man, 40 years of age, by the way, the older I get, 40 seems very young, tried to do God's will, and he failed. He failed because he tried to do it in his own strength. So the question that I need to ask myself is this, am I depending on my own strength or the Lord's strength? My strength, the Lord's strength. My wisdom or the Lord's wisdom. My timing or the Lord's timing. So we're going to take a look at three things, all related to Moses. The birth of Moses, the raising of Moses, and the failure of Moses. Now the good point is, there's more to the story, okay? We're going to end with a failure, but there's a lot more to go on. Remember, this is only phase one out of three phases. First of all, the birth of Moses. Now remember last week we said that the children of Israel had multiplied in Goshen. By this time, they had been there around 400 years. They had gone in as 72 people. You have Jacob, his name was changed to Israel. His 12 sons now are all there and their families. But they grew and they grew. And they multiplied. They were like rabbits in the land of Goshen. And last week we saw that when this new Pharaoh arose who knew not Joseph, he viewed them as a threat. So he tried making their life hard. He made them slaves. But the harder he made it, the more they prospered. The more that God blessed them. So he told the midwives, remember? If a male child is born to the Israelites, kill him. Well, they didn't do it. He said, why didn't you do it? He said, well, they're so strong, by the time we get there, they've already delivered. So then he gave a horrific order that went throughout all of Egypt, which apparently, according to some Bible scholars, applied to Egyptians as well as Jews. Any male child born, you're to throw him in the river and let him drown. All right, that's where we were at. Now chapter 2, verse 1. Now a man of the house of Levi went and married a daughter of Levi, and the woman conceived and bore a son. And when she saw him, that he was a beautiful child, she hid him 3 months. In the book of Acts, in chapter 7, you have Stephen's testimony before the Sanhedrin, before they stoned him to death. And now here he's preaching to them. And in Acts 7:17, it says this, "When the time of the promise drew near, which God had sworn to Abraham, the people grew and multiplied in Egypt, until another king rose up who did not know Joseph.
He dealt deceitfully with our people and mistreated our fathers, forcing them to put out their young children that they might not live. At that time, Moses was born and was fair in the sight of God, and he was reared for 3 months in his father's house. This is Stephen telling the history of Israel to the Jewish leaders.